Good morning, students. Welcome to the virtual classrooms. We are going to talk about today chemical properties for phenol. Now, we know it that we are going it for the aromatic. We studied it in alcohols also, that it is giving us electrophilic as well as nucleophilic substitution. The same thing we are going to get it for the phenol also. So first of all, we will go it for electrophilic substitution reactions of the phenol. Electrophilic substitution reaction for the phenol means we are going to get it not as an OH group to be replaced, not the H from it, but we are going it for the benzene, the aromatic nucleus going to lose its H. That means we are going it for the type of the reaction as nitration. We know it that for the nitration we are using it HNO3 and H2SO4. So what we are going to get it as a one phenol, OH group is already present on it. So that means the first characteristic we will have to recall it, that whether this OH is an orthopara-directing or meta-directing. It shows that OH group, it's an electron donating group. It's a electron donating group to the benzene nucleus. So it is going to act as an orthopara-directing. So the reaction with concentrated HNO3 plus concentrated H2SO4, it's going to give us orthonitrophenol plus paranitrophenol, right? So this nitration, but at the same time this is becoming an electron withdrawing group, so more reactivity is being increased in this compound. So this compound can furtherly go it for again nitration, and if its nitration is done with concentrated HNO3 and concentrated H2SO4, it produces 2,4-dinitrophenol. As we know that as the electron donating group is increasing, the acidic character of this compound is increasing, and it is going it for further reaction. It's also going it for reaction with HNO3 plus concentrated H2SO4 to produce 2,4,6-trinitrophenol, which is termed as picric acid. It's in yellow color. Now see, it does not contain any kind of an COOH carboxylic group. Still the name is written as acid. So this is your one of the objective question. Anthranilic acid, sulfanilic acid, benzoic acid and picric acid. Out of this, which one is not an carboxylic group containing acid? So what we will be having it? Sulfanilic acid or the picric acid. These are the two which do not contain carboxylic. Still they are acid in nature. And that's why we want to remember that picric acid, it's a one of the acid group, which is because of NO2 electron withdrawing group making phenol more and more stronger acid, right? Now this was for the nitration. Same thing, let's take it as the second one as bromination. Bromination of phenol. Now when we are talking about the bromination of the phenol, what we will be having it? Generally Br2, but here particularly for the phenol we are having something exceptional. We can take it as in water, you can take it Br2 in carbon disulfide, right? Now when we are doing it as in with water or with carbon disulfide, then we are having it as in two different reactions that have been possible, or the products are possible. The first one, that is phenol, it's reacted with Br2 CH2 273 Kelvin temperature. That means this reaction has to be carried out on cooling it, that is 0 degree Celsius. And the product you are going to get, it is a para-bromophenol, major product. Plus, you can say that ortho is obtained, but it's a minor product. Yeah. So when we are going it for such type of reactions with carbon disulfide, we got it either ortho or para, where ortho is very minor. You can say it as, this is 95%, this is 5%. Right? But in case of that, if you take it as a phenol to be reacted with water, it is also many times written as, this can be written as Br2 aqueous. The product you are going to get it in water as 2,4,6 tribromophenol together. All the three of them are going to replace 2,4,6 tribromophenol. All of them are going to be replaced at a time. Right? So that is a specification of the bromine. Okay, rest of it. Rest of the electrophilic substitution means you can say that sulfonation. When you are going it for the sulfonation, you are going to get it as concentrated H2SO4. The product you are going to get it is ortho plus para. Here we don't have any specifications or something certain different. It's going to be now the routine electrophilic substitution reaction of aromatic compounds. If I go for alkylation, I'm going to get it as a phenol with RX in presence of anhydrous AlCl3 FNC reaction OH R ortho plus para. During this case we got it as ortho plus para, right? So rest of the electrophilic substitution does not have, only nitration and bromination, they were the exceptions, right? Okay, next one we are having, it is a Kolbe's reaction. Now what is this reaction? In the Kolbe's reaction we are going to react phenol, right? There is a small difference that we want to indicate it in our textbook. In our textbook the temperature and pressure for the reaction is not specified. We will have to specify that reaction, and that is when you are taking it phenol, you know it that when you react it with NaOH, it gets converted into ONA, sodium phenoxide. The formation takes place very easily. Now this is known to us, but when we go it for this reaction, in our textbook it is written as CO2 H plus. Only the thing is, now for the first step, when I want to add CO2, I need 125 degree Celsius temperature plus 427 atmospheric pressure. Under this condition only, this reaction is going to carry out. Right? Actually, if I separate these two steps, let's do it as only the first one. What will happen? It will produce OCOONA, right? Which actually can't remain on, the bulky group cannot remain on it. So it immediately goes for rearrangement. And it gets converted into OHCOONA. Which on reaction with H plus gets converted into OHCOOH, right? But in our textbook what is done, this H plus is indicated over here and straight away the product is given to you, and this is salicylic acid. This salicylic acid is a one of the raw material for preparation of the medicines specifically like aspirin or methyl salicylate. It's a one of the important component, right? Now this is Kolbe's. So either of it, either in the, as per given in your textbook, if CO2 H plus you are writing it, straight away you can write this product, but make it sure condition is shown, right? So that make that changes in your textbook. That is your for the coal-based synthesis, right? This particular salicylic acid, why we told that it's an important, again this reaction are not given in your textbook, but they are going to be important for you, right? Once the salicylic acid is taken it, on reacting with acylation reaction, RCOCl, I'm going it for acylation. So at that time, what, because of the more reactive group is present on it, phenol goes for the reaction and it gets converted into the we'll take it as in the compound as OCOR, COOH and HCl is given out, right? This is known as, this is a particularly the compound known as aspirin, in which if I'm taking it as in CH3, this gets converted into methyl salicylate and aspirin. This particular compound is known as aspirin, right? And if I'm going it for CH3Cl, then at that time this CH3 reacts with OH in of COOH, CO CH3. It is termed as methyl salicylate. Now when we are going it for this reaction as a methyl salicylate, it's an having it as a phenolic OH group present on it, so it cannot be taken it as an oral drug. It has to be taken it as an external purpose. That means for the cold and cough, whatever the balms that you are using it, like Vicks paper or methyl this Jandu balm or Tiger balm or whatever it, they contain a main drug in it, and this is methyl salicylate. But in place of that, when we want to take it orally, that means I want to eat it, I can eat aspirin. The reason is its phenolic OH group is absent, right? So that can be your objective question, why methyl salicylate cannot be taken as an oral drug. It contains phenolic OH which burns the skin, right? So that is for the coal-based synthesis. The next reaction that we are having, it is a remerdiment. Remerdiment reaction, right? What is it given to us? We are having it as a phenol. It's reacted with CHCl3 plus NaOH. During this case, when you are having it as a CHCl3, that is chloroform in NaOH, it goes for the substitution reaction on CHCl2, HCl is given out, right? It produces an intermediate because the presence of the NaOH. This NaOH, which is present in the reaction, it reacts with the Cl, so it produces unstable and that is OH, CH. Now, two OH groups are present on the same carbon. They cannot hold it. That is a chemical property of the compound, that if a single carbon is containing two OH group, it cannot hold it. It removes out in the form of H2O and it gets converted into aldehyde. It gets converted into salicylaldehyde, right? So this compound with a chloroform gets converted into, this is a stable compound, but when, because of the presence of NaOH in the reaction, it immediately converts itself into salicylic aldehyde, right? So that is the remerdiment reaction that we are having. The next one that we are having, it is reaction with Zn, phenol. When it's reacted with Zn dust, on heating it, it gets converted into benzene. Now this is the one of the important reaction for as a point of view of conversion. For the conversion, this is going to be very important for us. Okay? So phenol with Z and S gets converted into benzene. Oxidation. When you are having it as a phenol, oxidation. We know it that we are going to do it with K2Cr2O7. Or it gets converted into benzoquinone. It converts into benzoquinone. Right? These are all the chemical properties of phenol that we are having it for our syllabus. Right, the next point that is given to us for the alcohol and phenol is the two of the important components of the alcohol phenol, that is methanol and ethanol. Right, we know it that we are having it as a different methods for preparation of alcohols or different compounds from the different compounds, right? But these are the specific compounds. So we are having it as in specific methods also for the preparation given to us. So first of all, we'll go it for methanol. Now we know it that I can have it as in methyl chloride reacted with aqueous NaOH, it will get converted into methanol. Right? But specifically, industrial preparation. Industrial preparation of methanol is done with carbon monoxide. Right? Before I write it, the common name of it. It's a wood spirit. Right? This was prepared from the wood, but now it is prepared from the CO. It's a carbon monoxide. When carbon monoxide is reacted with 2H2 in presence of ZnO Cr2O3 at 200 to 300 degree Celsius temperature. See, the conditions are very important. You have to specify the conditions, right? 200 to 300 atmospheric pressure. Temperature we are going to get it as 573 to 673 Kelvin. CO plus H2, it gets converted into CH3OH, methanol, in presence of ZnOCl. This is an industrial preparation of methanol nowadays, right? It's a very useful, it's a colorless liquid. But the problem of this methanol is, it's a one of the poisonous substance. If any person tries to drink the methanol, then there is a possibility of going it for blindness or even to the death. Right, this methanol is particularly used for preparation of solvents. It's used as an one of the solvent, as well as the most important preparation of the compound that is produced from methanol, that is formaldehyde, that is CH3OH on oxidation produces HCHO. This is the most important use of methanol, right, other than the solvent. But it's also an being a poisonous substance, has to be very carefully handled, right? Okay, similarly, the second one we are having it is a ethanol. Now, it's, we know it, ethanol means an alcohol, right? Many of the peoples, they are consuming the alcohols. Now, for that case, what we are doing it is, from, we are studying the preparation from sugarcane. Sugarcane contains C12H22O11, that is sucrose that is present in it. Now this sucrose, by the help of hydrolysis, invertase enzyme, the fermentation reaction is carried out. By the help of this, the fermentation is reaction is carried out. It produces C6H12O6, C6H12O6. I wrote it both of them as in same formula. They are the molecular formula, but both these compounds are different. One is glucose, one is fructose. One is containing aldehyde group, one is containing ketone. So both of them are different. They are isomers of each other. Right? We'll study it later on in our some other chapter. But this can convert into glucose plus fructose. When this compound is furtherly taken and hydrolyzed in presence of zymase enzyme, we get it converted into C2H5OH plus 2CO2. So during this, we got it as alcohol, right? Ethanol is produced. This ethanol is containing additional amount of the water. CO2 is vaporized, right? So it's not a pure form. It contains small amount of water. So by vaporizing it, by distillation, when this ethanol is taken it for the distillation, the water is removed. Okay, during distillation, C2H5OH and 5% H2O forms these. You have studied it, the meaning of azeotropic mixture. Both of them are having same boiling point. Now it is difficult to separate this compound. Both of them are going to distilled out at the same temperature, so it's not possible to separate it. So this particular azeotropic mixture has to be separated. And if I want 100% alcohol ethanol, then the water has to membrane technology. That is a particular method that is used to remove the 5% water also. So this is known as azeotropic mixture, and if I want to remove it, I have to use membrane technology, right? But when industrially this alcohols are prepared and to make it and useful for chemical reactions and to avoid the people to drink it, what is done in it? Like nowadays what you are utilizing it, sanitizers, right? You will generally find out that they are blue in color. What is the responsible factor for it? We know it that in the sanitizer, we need it as in 70% alcohol and rest is water. So what will happen? The people will start to drink it. To avoid it, what is done in it? Certain time, in a certain compounds, what they do it is, they add copper sulfate solution. And therefore, your sanitizers generally are blue in color, because they are containing so small amount of the copper sulfate, so you can now drink it, otherwise a person will die, right? So to avoid it, or some type of an smell containing components, like if I want to add a foul smell containing components, we add pyridine in it, right? That means the foul smell will avoid for the people to drink that. So to avoid that drinking, we are adding in the given compound either copper sulfate or in a small quantity a foul smell containing component like pyridine, right? So these two are the specific components that have been told to us to be studied in this chapter. Now the last topic that is left out for the ethers, we saw it, IUPAC nomenclature of ethers, we saw the electronic structures also, but what about the physical chemical properties? We will study it in the next lecture. Right? Thank you.